All right. I don't know if you've noticed, but we've been witnessing a bit of a deluge of humanoid bots of every shape and variation. Some great and others, well, let's just say you don't want them standing next to your bed at 3 a.m., if you know what I mean. Like this latest version of a humanoid bot from Clone Robotics. Now, mind you, it's just a torso. And I know it looks a bit like a xenomorph, but they've adopted a radically different and rather interesting approach to biomimicry of the human musculoskeletal form factor in this humanoid bot. So let's get in the experts to break this all down for us. Scott Walter is a mechanical and aerospace engineer and two-time founder of robotics companies. And making his grand debut on Over the Horizon is Gustav Andersson, consultant hand surgeon and associate professor of anatomy. He's joining us from Umeo in Sweden. I hope I got that pronunciation right. Welcome, gentlemen. Great to have you.
Thank you.
You're here. And it's great to meet Gustav.
Yep. All right. So let's begin with first impressions. And Gustav, since this is your first time on Over the Horizon, please, why don't you take the lead?
Yeah. So I've seen similar ideas, at least with a muscular basis, being hydraulics and liquid based, looking at the shape of the anatomy of where they put the cables and tubing and the skeleton. It looks very anatomically correct, or at least they're attempting to do so. My focus is primarily on the hands and the lower part of the upper extremity, and there they are positioned in a very human-esque way, I think. Of course, the movement in this demo is perhaps not the most natural and might seem a bit stiff around the shoulder joints and so on. And also, I can kind of get an impression that some of the tubing might hinder the motion if you're looking at the upper part of the arm where it can't really extend the elbow fully due to this. I like the idea. It's promising. Question is, how durable is it and how much control can you get over this kind of motor shapes?
Right. And Scott, well, you've reviewed quite a few humanoid bots. What is your take? How does this differ from what we've seen with, let's say, Tesla Optimus or some of the Chinese bots?
Well, if I hadn't already been following Clone Robotics like for the past year, I would have just thought, oh, this is like some new Halloween decoration that's come out because this is October. But we've already seen a lot from them. We saw them doing quite a bit with like their forearm and hand a few months ago. And yeah, this has been in the roadmap. They sort of shown that they want to go the entire humanoid right down to actually having bipedalism. And I think to make it really short, the impression that I gave was like, this is the future of humanoid robotics, but it's the far future. So right. I really applaud this effort. And I agree with Gustav. We don't know about durability, how easy it's going to be to control. But you won't be able to solve those engineering problems if someone doesn't attempt to go down this path. And so I like the fact that there are some companies, you know, 1X is an example, that they're doing tendon-based controls and just trying to see, you know, can you get that to work, even though there are others that are very, very skeptical. And so the first thing you're looking at that, is this crazy? Yes, absolutely. Is it practical? Probably not right now, but I'm pretty sure in a decade or so, humanoid bots may look a bit more like this than the mechanical ones we're seeing right now. So the mechanical ones, we can get progress really quickly. They're gonna be in the factory in the matter of months. This is gonna take a while to get there. But again, you're not gonna learn what the problems are and what the solutions are. But the one thing I can say that Gustav sort of alluded to is, like, you know, the control of this thing. 10 years ago, you wouldn't even attempt to try to control something like that because you just know the software would be a nightmare. But now that you're starting to look at machine learning and AI, it starts to make it possible to think about controlling a mechanism like this, because there's so many variables. There's so much coupling and dependencies between things that you're not even aware of when you try to do the modeling of it. So, you know, as you bend one limb, you have no idea what it's going to end up doing to the tension. If they're using tendons, in this case, I think using hydraulics, it's going to impact that, which means other digits, other limbs are just going to suddenly start to move a little bit, even though you don't intend to, because the motion is something.
Yeah, and I like the, as I mentioned earlier, the idea of them really mimicking the human form. And as you say, some motions start appearing that you maybe didn't really realize if you go the pure engineering point of view with traditional engines or actuators. So them going for the pure anatomic, trying to mimic the human anatomy as far as possible is probably a good idea if this is the approach they're going. I've always like fought between the what is practical in the short term to get it into production and get it into industry, and how can you use these kind of robots, and then on the other hand, how far can we go? As you mentioned, and I often feel the same within the field of surgery, is like if no one is pushing on the edge, we will never go any further. So it's quite easy to say that, oh, your wrist is in pain, let's do a let's make it stiff and orthodesis, and then you won't feel any pain and you'll have a strong grip. But if no one starts developing the prosthetics or the arthroplasties that can keep your motion, then we will never get there, and we'll never know how far we can go. So yeah, you need to push the envelope a little bit.
Yeah, and there's a lot of emotions that you're going to be getting out of a mechanism like that will be closer to how we actually move versus the way the current humanoid bots are doing it. And the one thing that I've always kind of pointed out is that, you know, nature has to evolve certain kinds of mechanical things based on the limits of what nature can do. So nature can't come up with an electric motor the way we have. And at the same time, we're not able to mimic muscles exactly the way nature is doing it. So you have a lot of joints in there that we will model in a biomechanics lab as like, oh, that's a hinge joint. But if you look at it really closely, no, it's not a hinge joint at all. It's basically two bones that are kind of moving across each other with a fulcrum being held together, which with ligaments, which are basically like, you know, just rubber bands kind of holding it in there. And that's not how you would actually engineer or build something like that. You're going to build it like a real hinge joint. So they become analogs, but they're not perfect analogs. Yeah. And then we get to the shoulder joint, where nature has actually come up with a mechanical joint that exists in engineering labs. And it's just a ball and socket joint. It's absolutely there. Yet no one is using a ball and socket joint for the shoulder or for the hips because of the difficulty of actuating it. So they have to come up with a completely different strategy, which while it emulates the movement of a human shoulder, doesn't precisely do it. So my overall feeling is that, you know, when you finally get some of these bots, you know, like, you know, from 1X or Optimus or Figure out there, and you start playing catch with them and you want them to throw a ball a particular way, the way the shoulder is going to articulate, it's probably not going to be exactly the same way we do, because our shoulder doesn't have these motors at right angles. It has these muscle groups that are not necessarily orthogonal to each other, which means in certain kind of movements or directions, the torques that are being applied are very different than the torques you're going to get out of that. So you just kind of get a very different kind of motion than what you would expect from a mechanism. And so when you start doing this, you start getting closer and closer to what human type motions are going to look like. And then people will, it'll be harder and harder to distinguish a humanoid from a real human because of that. Yeah. The challenges, of course, are going to be definitely the durability. I mean, both the internal durability, because we just don't know what it's going to be like to have that kind of actuation strategy and how much they're going to be able to do through repetition of motion. And then you also need to skin this thing somehow. So the clone hand was like really impressive, really creepy. But, you know, the feeling is if you actually start using it in some sort of production environment, it's probably going to tear or rip or wear out really quickly. So you're going to have to constantly be recovering that skin or putting some kind of durable material on it. So those are the challenges going ahead. Doesn't mean they won't be solved. Just right now, we don't know how to solve them.
Yeah. And just as you were mentioning with the ligaments, you can kind of tell in this clip that the fingers scissor over each other because they lack like lateral support in the MCP joint or whatever when they grip the ball. That one's a nice catch, but then later on it kind of crosses the fingers, and that's perhaps not a big problem for this type of activity, but when you start lifting heavy objects or whatever, it's going to be tricky. So there are many components of the
So you think they're not actually using hinge joints at all, but they're really emulating the human body as far as
There was one part of this clip where the ring finger kind of clips over the little finger a little bit, and but the thumb motion is really impressive, I think, especially when you compare it with other software out there. And they really get the opposition as far as I would like it to go. With the new Optimus hand, they only show it reaching like the middle finger or something. They never really cross over to the fifth digit or down to the fifth metacarpal, which is like the furthest you would want someone to be able to pose.
Are you saying that this is the movement here is kind of more advanced than the Optimus hand, the third gen hand? And
at least the range
of product with Dr. Iyer in the last episode.
At least the range of motion looks more promising, and it's, as you always hear people say, that it's easy to do a demo, and the still frames of the hand holding a scalpel and so on can be very easily posed in a way that you would prefer. But there are some of these films where they move the thumb towards the little fingers on that kind of shows a bigger range of motion, but it's hard to tell. But the real
yeah is. And again, it comes down to the actuation strategy, because what Optimus has done, and you'll also see it in others, I think Figure is doing this, and probably also 1X, is right about here, they have a hinge joint for the thumb. And so it's basically articulating about that. But this joint down here, I think that's the CMC joint. That's really a ball and socket joint again. So what they're doing is like you get this full range of motion because you kind of have a ball and socket. The way it's actuated, you know, it's like you got tendons and muscles that are kind of pulling in a particular way. But because of that, it allows a kind of articulation that little hinge there is kind of limiting. You know, it's saying it folds around. It's like, no, it doesn't. Really bending around there in a different direction. And so they're going through, and this has been hard to figure out from the Optimus hand. So, yeah, so you can see how that hinges around there. They also have the flexion in there, and then they may have, I'm not quite sure what the joint is, because it doesn't look like they're showing the abduction. So this motion here, that hinge, I believe that's opposition.
Yeah, so moving the opposition is like reaching towards your little finger, creating like a circular shape, whereas if your thumb would go into your wrist, that's called a flexion. So it's almost looks the same, but opposition is creating this grip around circular objects or whatever. And so it's you have the MP joint of the thumb, or this joint, is like a hinge joint. It doesn't really, it's not like the index finger's MP joint, which is more of like an egg-shaped joint that you could do some circumduction with. The thumb's MP joint is very hinge-like. Whereas here you have what's called a saddle joint, one of the few saddle joints, possibly the only one in the human body, which is like someone sitting in a saddle. So you have abduction, flexion, and extension, but not really rotation there either. So it's the combined motion of the movement laterally and medially, should be radial only, and then flexion, extension, and then in the next joint, which would be between your scaphoid and the trapezoid. Trapezoid is the English word, I think. That's where you have a little bit of rotation and sliding motion. But yeah, the opposition is very important for at least what we consider a good hand function. And in order to facilitate that, you also have, which I think you talked about last time, the motion of the fifth metacarpal and the fourth. They they can move a little bit to increase the arch of the hand, whereas the first two are very stiff, and they are mostly to transfer load from your knuckles and your fingers. And so Tesla has adopted that here, which looks good. But as you say, the adduction and abduction of the thumb might not really be, at least not the adduction. And that is quite important when you try to grip things and holding your key card or a key. So you can emulate that with flexing your thumb towards your finger. But in human impatience, that's considered to be the result of a nerve injury. So it's not the ideal motion. And you won't have a strong grip if you lose the possibility to adduct the thumb towards your index finger, for instance.
Exactly. And that's what we want to make clear is the abduction is taking your hand and allowing the fingers to move back and forth like this, including the thumb.
Yeah.
And I can't really see the actuator in there that gives the abduction of the thumb. That was not clear to me. But it looks like they have something that allows the thumb to twist. And of course, like, I mean, we can't do that. We can't do that twisting motion. But the thing is, when it comes to orientation, there's a variety of ways that you can orient anything in space. This is a different combination of what they call Euler angles. And what they may have done is, like, rather than really mimicking exactly how the human body works, they decided, well, we know you don't have that thumb twist, but if you kind of combine that thumb twist with some movement on the others, it will come very close to looking like abduction. So we can see the flexion is definitely there. We can see the opposition reposition is there, but I've been having a really hard time teasing out where is the abduction coming from, whether it's hidden somewhere else, because it's not clear. And again, once they built that kind of hinge there, they made it very difficult from a mechanical standpoint on how to get that abduction. Yeah, it's really easy to put something in there to make the mechanical thumb twist. Mm. Like you say, I think it's because of the saddle joint or something that's in there. You can't do that, you know? And even here with our fingers, I think it's sort of like a spherical joint that we have there.
Yes, but it's like
because of the ligaments, it really prevents you from being able to roll. So technically, you should be able to roll your finger based on the joint design, but the body puts the mixture. No, you can't do that. And do not at home try to twist your finger. You can only move in two directions.
I need the patience. So please do.
Yeah.
But no, you're totally right. And so the PIP and DIP joint, they are purely hinge joints, or that's how they function. But if you, as you say, you can rotate them a little bit. They're quite flat at the surface. Whereas this is more like not really a ball and socket, because you can't rotate the finger at the MP joint. So it's more like the ellipsoid joint, I think it's called in English. Mm-hmm. We call it egg joint in Swedish.
Yeah.
And it's similar with the wrist. You have like an egg joint down there, so you can flex extend radially and ulnar deviate, and then do kind of like a circumduction, but you can't rotate the wrist in itself.
Right. So that rotation comes to the forearm way down here. Yeah. So, yeah.
And that's also something that would be more lifelike in this clone robot or arm, which has the ulna and the radius exactly like it looks like a 3D printed, basically, the human skeleton, and put this machinery on top. Whereas I have a hard time seeing the Tesla bot having that, because when you do your supination and pronation, you don't really twist the whole arm. You rotate the radius over the ulna. The ulna stays still all the time. So it's just the radius that crosses over the ulna to create this pronation of the hand, and supination, they go parallel again. So if you look at anatomical models, they usually stand with the palms forward, and that's because then the bones are parallel. Whereas if you're in this position, the radius has kind of rotated across the ulna, and I don't see the Tesla bot or others doing that. And then the question is, do they really need to? Probably not.
They don't do it. Again, that's sort of emulating the motion we have. So industrial robots have just done that for years, is that what they would call their fourth axis. They have a choice. They can rotate it down here, or they can rotate it up there. You just decide where you want the motors to be. But when it rotates, it's one rigid body that's going. So most of them, a lot of them, it's like about halfway in between on the forearm, because the motor is down here, and then it's connected up there. And then you will see a circle that goes right around here. And then the rest of the forearm is just a conical shape. And it rotates right on there. Mm. Whereas, of course, in our bodies, it's flexing the whole way. And however, if you go into like some gaming systems and stuff like that, that will have avatars in there, you may notice they do the same thing. That basically, at some point, it twists around there. And the problem with that is you got to make it circular, because if you have like the real shape of the forearm, this doesn't make a circle. So if I do that cut, I basically have an ellipsoid. And when it's made it together, it looks right. But once you begin to rotate one of them, you begin to see the system is coming apart, because you've got two ellipsoids that are off in different directions, and you get a gap in there, and it doesn't look very good. So this has always been the bane of people who are trying to simulate like the human body, is like, how do you do this as a rigid body? Because rigid bodies are like really easy in computer graphics. But to make it right, you would then have to have a surface that deforms all the way around there. And calculating a surface that's deforming to get that shape in computer graphics, that requires a lot of work. It's very hard to do. And of course, the same thing in reality, seeing if you want to do that, you're going to have to put some sort of skin, which is flexible to move around. And the humanoid bots is like, no, we're not going to do that. They're going to be mechanical, and you're going to see that seam there, and you're going to see how that joint spins around there. And then that becomes a problematic area, because whenever you have a joint like that, it means things can get in. So you have to put gaskets and other things to make sure dirt and moisture doesn't happen to get in there. Fingers don't get in there. And that's just there. Of course, when you get to the elbow and others, it gets even worse when it comes to pinch points.
It would be interesting to know, or if maybe they showed in earlier clips, the clone robot, what kind of joint structures they have, if it's just smooth surfaces against each other. I saw some post about a kid that they had interviewed or something that made it's a frictionless joint. So the human joint has a very low friction coefficient, or mammal joints, like I think it's 0.005 or something, whereas the ideal ball bearing is like 0.05, or like a 10 times less, or whatever you call it. But there is this open source project called the Dex Hand, and they use these ball bearing joints. And I kind of like this design because they go for the tendon way with the strings, and then they have an extensor tendon, and they have one flexor tendon, which is not really the same. We have two flexors, and then the ball bearings really give a really low friction to have a nice joint movement. And then they have this I think it's one guy actually, they have this nice ligament structure. I don't know if you can tell, it's a darker color, this rope, which kind of emulates the intrinsic function of our finger. So even if I bend it at this angle, it will still flex the distal joint. So this lacks the MP joint now, but the idea I will have is that if you flex, it's gonna flex the whole finger, and if you extend it, it's gonna extend. Now I'm getting the tendons mixed up here. It's gonna extend the whole finger. So what I lack in most of these robots otherwise is that when you do the flexion of the MP joint, which is how I got interested in your post earlier, is that you really want to be able to extend the PIP and DIP joints at the same time. So in the human anatomy, the muscles inside the hand, the intrinsics, as we sometimes call them, or the interossei and lumbricals, they flex the fingers at the MP joint, but they also extend the PIP and DIP joints.
Yep.
I don't know if
Means in your model, if you pull properly on both of those tendons, you can get that emulated motion, right?
Yeah. So what I haven't gotten too far yet. I've just printed the parts, but there are connectors here next to this pin, which I presume is for this MP joint flexion part. So that would be a separate actuator that would pull on this part of the fingers to not pull the whole finger to flex it.
Okay. So what
we see in the...
Can you do that basically just with a puppet string? So if you pull on the flexor right now, you're going to get the whole thing to curl.
Yeah, exactly. If
you put tension on both the flexor and the extensor at the same time, does that allow you to kind of straighten it out? Because now you have kind of an opposition force.
Yeah, exactly. You probably do, but I expect it to become a little bit stuck in between with this design, that you won't really get the real extension of the fingers. Okay. But you could probably balance that with your servos or whatever engine you're using. So this system,
now,
I think,
has now you're seeing it's hard for you. You're the puppeteer right now, and I'm asking you.
It's really hard for me to pull it. Yeah,
because you're trying to figure out what's the amount I have to do that.
Yeah, I don't have the joint here to pull against, so perhaps it will be easier. But it's hard just to get it to flex without falling apart. Yeah.
But still, knowing the right amount is a bit tricky, and that's where the good control system and the neural nets are going to have to go through and learn that behavior. Mm-hmm. And part of that behavior is going to be a lot of feedback, probably almost visual feedback. I don't know what kind of proprioception or sensors are going to have in there. You know, they might be feeling the tension, but we know tendons are just finicky beasts, and you get friction and everything else. So the inputs that worked yesterday may not be the same inputs that are going to work today, and you're going to have to adjust that a little bit. But it looks like, again, they can have that. And again, what was pointed out in that video is the importance, and this is something that Dr. Iyer kind of pointed out, is that, you know, we assume that we go and grab things, that's okay to just have our fingers closed down like that. And if you do that, you're going to miss the thing you're trying to grasp, which is why it's very important that you kind of come down straight at first and then do that curl. Mm. which is why the Tesla bot or the new hand has those two tendons. Mm. Whereas in the past, it just had that one. It just had, and again, if you can show that, I think for a lot of members of the audience, we know we have tendons in there, but it's always a mystery and how like pulling on a tendon one way can actually cause this curling thing. Cause it almost goes against your own kind of logic of like, that doesn't make sense. Mm. That thing would kind of curl around. You'd almost think it would go the other way. And a lot of it has to do with the way the tendons are wrapped around the different joints to be able to kind of get them to get into that curling mode. And the fact that another string just kind of put in there in a different way actually allows it to pop open the other direction.
So this is it's a bit advanced. So just to give you a feeling, so you have the long extensor tendon. So this is what Elon wanted to move up to the forearm. So I kind of took offense with his, when it says almost all muscles are in the forearm, and there are a lot, but there are actually more in the hand than in the forearm controlling the fingers and the hand. So there's like 18 or 19 in the forearm and there are 19 in the hand. So almost the same. But the long extensor tendon actually more or less inserts here just below the PIP joint, the first joint of the finger. And then the force is transferred via some lateral ligaments or tendon parts going from this extensor tendon, but primarily pulled upon by these intrinsic muscles within the hand. And here you can also see the flexor tendons of the fingers, which there are two of. And the deep one that goes the furthest out into the fingertip actually goes through the superficial flexor tendon, which could, if you want to mimic it, cause quite an issue, I think. At least surgically, it's an issue. If you have a wound or injury to this area of the tendons, it's a high chance of the tendons scarring together and not creating a very well-functioning hand. So I think this is the picture I posted on X. Mm-hmm. From Grey's Anatomy, not the TV series. And here is the intrinsic muscles, the interossei, the tendons that are between the bones. That's what it means. And that has its, we call it the fulcrum, or the path goes volar to the axis of the MP joint, and then it passes up dorsally and pulls on this extensor tendon mechanism, which is by partly from these tendons, from the intrinsic muscles, but also from the long extensor tendon that splits up and kind of attaches distally. So when you activate your intrinsics, these interossei and the lumbricals, which are the other muscles in the hand controlling the fingers, you will get this kind of motion where you flex the MP joint and extend the interphalangeal joints. And without this, you wouldn't, it would, at least we humans are not able to extend the fingers at the same time as we flex the MP joints. And the lumbricals, they don't attach to the bone or originate from the bone. They originate actually from these deep flexor tendons. So it's like connected to the flexor tendon that then travels out into the finger. So it's a tricky kind of setup. But yeah, in order to get this function, you need the muscles in here to pull the finger down, but then also transfer the force to the back or your finger to extend it. And yeah, if you lose your function in this, if you have like a ulnar nerve injury, your hand will turn out like this when you try to extend it. And if you also have a median nerve injury, so if you cut both nerves, your hand will look like this when you stretch, or your fingers will stretch like this. You can't really extend them anymore. If you get support for your MP joint, you might get a little bit better extension, but usually it looks like this. And when you try to grasp something, it's just as how you showed, that the fingers will curl up and go in, so you won't really be able to grasp around an object. So the part of the grasping, it's very important, but then when we come to the really fine details of picking up a card or playing the guitar and adding the force, it's one thing to do the motion, but to push down on the strings when you do your barre or whatever it's called, you really need to have that extension of the fingers while exerting force to it. And also like the piano with your abduction and splaying of the fingers, that's all done by these muscles. So I got a bit nervous when Elon said, oh, we're moving all the muscles into the forearm, because that's the way human anatomy is, and perhaps you could still emulate these intrinsic functions. But it, I was like, I hope they talk to some hand surgeon or work therapist or someone to.
Maybe you could offer your services.
Yes, yeah, no,
but in Tesla's defense, I think what Elon was perhaps talking about was the long-term vision, the long-term goals. And Scott, correct me if I'm wrong, but the Gen 3 hand that we saw at 1010 is not the final version of the hand for sure.
Probably not. And we're all trying to figure out how big that package is going to be with those actuators. Again, I'm all over the map. I'm guesstimating they might have up to 24 actuators to be able to get all the different motions that they want to have, which is kind of crazy because it's 22 degrees of freedom and now suddenly you have more actuators, and trying to figure out how they stack all them in. And there's a lot we're not seeing underneath it. So it could be that for now, just for the initial test, even though those are probably, I'm not sure if they're metal tendons or if they're using, you know, some sort of Kevlar or something like that. They definitely look like they're sheathed. I think they have to be sheathed because you just can't have wires cutting across each other like that through the carpal tunnel. They're just going to saw themselves in half. So they've got to be protected. Whether those are actually electric actuators they have in there, which I was assuming to make that motion go up and down. But it's also possible they could be doing hydraulic right now, which means they would have like a lot underneath that you don't see because they're in the early prototyping phase. So it's possible that this is like nowhere near what the final hand is because they're just trying to get an idea of what the motions are like and whether it's capable. I think the other thing that Gustav has kind of pointed out there, when you look at the complexity of the fingers and all the different tendons and stuff like that in there, the fact that we humans are able to like master that movement, you know, so easily, you know, we can just say, yeah, make your fingers go straight. And we just know exactly how to do that. It's rather amazing that we can do that.
Right.
But
also
then if you actually make the mechanism and we get a pull on it, oh, is that hard?
Yeah. But also Gustav raised an interesting point about friction. And Scott, we spoke about friction in the Gen 3 and with all those wires and actuators and rubbing against each other. You brought it up in the last chat. The benefit of human joints and the human body is that you've got synovial fluid in joints, which reduces the friction.
Yeah.
So from your point of view, Gustav, do you think there's anything that in terms of biomimicry that can be learned as far as the joints are concerned? And, you know, the human joints are really complex.
Yeah. And there is still too complex. I mean, there are no good regenerative pathways for a ruined joint today. The surgical options are very rough. It's like making the joint stiff or replacing it with a artificial joint, which will wear out in 5 to 10 years normally, at least in the hand. The joint replacements are quite poor.
Yeah.
And then the third option is like making a slink joint where you kind of remove the cartilage and let it just be a fibrotic joint. So there is no way to regenerate cartilage and the synovial fluid if you have that ruined. So I don't really, and that's why I was interested in seeing how they plan or this clone group, what they are planning on doing, or if they have a thought of it at all, or if they're mainly focusing perhaps on the muscle construction at the moment. So
Yeah, because as someone who's kind of had a stress fracture in his knee and having torn his meniscus, I know just how precious that can be. And, you know, just when you talk about biomimicry and kind of taking inspiration from the human musculoskeletal form factor, it just boggles the mind about the sheer complexity of human joints and the tendons and the muscles and how they all work together, antagonistic muscles and all of that. It's just, is it possible to replicate that in a biomechanical form factor for, let's say, a humanoid robot, or are we perhaps being too hopeful?
Yeah, at the moment, I can't really think of a way. I probably, you know better, Scott, with what's in the industry, but with the replacement joints that we have, they are all mechanical. I mean, there's different kind of coatings to the ball and socket, but it's nothing to kind of recreate the joint capsule and the synovial fluid production that is nowhere near where we are now. So,
yeah.
And I'm thinking if you make like
a serviceability is going to be such a big problem.
Exactly. I mean, if you have a fluid that starts leaking and you need to replace it, and how do you kind of, it needs to be a self-repair itself somehow, and that's not
even close. Hydraulic systems are a bit, so I think they're using hydraulics, not pneumatics. I would almost go, I would prefer pneumatics in some ways just because there's some built-in compliance. The problem you've always had with hydraulics is that they're extremely stiff. Because they're so stiff, they actually have to leak a little bit. So they intentionally make these things a little bit leaky to be able to get the compliance you need. And that's the one thing that people really don't like, having to deal with hydraulic systems like that.
Yeah, you can't keep adding WD-40 all the time, can you?
Yeah. But you know, these are things that'll be worried. You know, with pneumatics, it's not so bad because it's a compressible fluid, whereas hydraulics is incompressible. Which is why you want to put it in forklifts and stuff like that, is because it's a really easy way to be able to deliver force at a distance without any real complexity, you know, just flexible lines and stuff like that. But at the same time, I mean, those flexible lines have to be really strong to be able to support the fluid that's in there. In this case, you don't need that, but these things are very, very small. So I think they're using either pneumatics or hydraulics for that and aren't actually using tendons themselves. But In the sense, if you're using tendons, you're going to have the same kind of almost wiring diagram there. Mm-hmm. And the thing to remember with most of the tendons are going to be like a bicycle cable. They're going to be sheathed and they're going to move through there. But if these bots are doing 24/7, you take anyone and you have them do a difficult task, you know, 20 hours a day, 7 days a week, they will develop something called tendonitis. And these, it's the same thing's going to happen there. Is you're going to get the wear and the tear and the reliability. Now, the advantage that the human body has is that so long as like you don't overdo it at night, we self-repair a bit. So the next morning you can kind of go out there and you'll be all right. And that's why usually people don't have tendonitis. But, you know, having trained for marathons and stuff like that, I know as soon as you overdo it, the first thing you get is like usually in the knee or in the ankle somewhere, that's going to flare up. And then again, depending upon the awkwardness of a movement. You know, we're well aware of metacarpal syndrome. The idea is that I keep on telling people, you know, this is the one thing I always ask, if you could take a joint out of your humanoid bot, which would be the one you would take out? Mm-hmm. And in some ways, this wrist movement, while it's very nuanced and very important to kind of the dexterity you need, you could almost argue that's the one you don't want to have, because you will see that there are a lot of people that because they have, carpal tunnel syndrome, a lot of times they'll be wearing a brace or something like that that prevents their hand from going around, and they can still get through the day. They still are able to accomplish all kinds of things. You've just made sure, no, you're not allowed to do that movement anymore. And the reason is because the ball and socket joint that we have up in the shoulder actually causes what's called redundancy of the movement of the wrists. This is something that industrial robots have actually taken out, is they don't have a proper ball and socket joint on their shoulder. They only have 2 degrees of freedom, whereas all the humanoid bots have decided to put 3. And because of that, you can almost get away with that. Now, you know, Figure and others have given themselves a lot of movement in that wrist compared to the Tesla bot, which is much closer to the human anatomy. And Gustav, you can tell me, what is the range of motion? And this is what you can tell. They did not have a biomechanist in the room when they were working this stuff, because they call this wrist yaw. Was that supination and pronation? I'm just trying to remember.
No, so this is like ulnar and radial deviation. But usually when we use the wrist, it's combined with a flexion and extension at the same time. So something called the dart thrower's motion is something that is considered very important for the wrist motion. If you're a carpenter or if you're throwing darts or painting or whatever, it's what they try to recreate, the ones who build like your arthroplasties for the wrist. They want to recreate the dart throw motion. But it's almost like a joke within wrist surgical, call it, groups, that title of some conferences are called anything but a wrist fusion, because everyone kind of knows that the wrist fusion is the best for the patient in the end. Because even if you have a really nice arthroplasty or other surgical technique, in the end, when you ask the patients 2 years after their procedure, the happiest patients are the ones who got a wrist fusion. And the wrist fusion means you can't flex, extend, ulnar or radial deviate your wrist anymore. It's stiff, like you're wearing a brace. But you can, of course, pro and supinate your hand still, but mm-hmm. it will really hinder you in a lot of fine mechanical work.
Sure.
But those patients who get this or who get an arthroplasty, the main reason they get it is because of pain. The range of motion or like lack of range of motion is not really a big problem for most patients, unless you have a lack of extension of your wrist. If your wrist is flexed, then that's a problem because you become weak and feeble in your finger flexors. You need to have the wrist extended to make them strong, thanks to the pulley system.
Okay, so
as long as you have your wrist a little bit extended, you have a really strong grip. So if someone comes to me and they're like 20 years old and they busted their wrist and you can't fix it because the cartilage is gone or whatever, you should not offer them a artificial joint because they will wear it out within 5 or 10 years, maybe a little bit more. And then when they're in their 30s, you're going to try to fix that. And that's the nightmare of an orthopedic or a hand surgeon or whichever field you're in, to remove that joint. And then what's left is like an empty hole where you need to put something. And then you need to take bone from somewhere else, from a bone bank or grafting. So if you're a 20-year-old and your life, you're going to be a carpenter or something, then the best option, and it sounds a bit traumatic, is to have a wrist fusion to make your wrist stiff. At least that's what I would suggest to patients. We have pretty good arthroplasties, but they wear out and then you're in a much worse situation. So yeah, I would remove that. If you want to simplify, if we're talking about how can we get this functioning as fast as possible, because as you mentioned, you remove a lot of the friction of the tendons and on the joints. So most likely these robots will be quite quick into faster to engineer. And then the next one would be the MP joint of the thumb. If you have a well-functioning saddle joint or CMC joint, the MP joint, if you make that stiff, no one will notice. No one will miss it. Perhaps if you're a piano player who really needs to activate, but the best joint to make stiff in the hand is the MP joint of the thumb. You will get a strong grip. You will be able to oppose your thumb. You will be able to do almost anything. You could even be a hand surgeon. It's
wow.
And then, as we mentioned quite early, with just the final joint is the DIP joint. So the original design, they kind of made the joint fixed up here, or at least it wasn't the DIP.
They fused the DIP joint, and but they put a little bit of arch in it.
Yeah,
and then and they took the proximal phalanx and made it a little bit longer.
Exactly.
So they basically took the PIP joint and moved it up a little bit. So that was kind of how they decided that, well, I mean, here it's flexing at what, about a third of the way down, or, you know, it's a little bit. So they kind of wanted to put it more like halfway because they figured, well, that's a good compromise for if you're going to polygonalize like a circle or something like that, you want somewhere in between it. And we'll just give it a little bit of built-in arch to begin with.
Yeah,
exactly. And again, that's where it seemed like good engineering compromise. If you're thinking about how to reduce the complexity of a system.
Yeah. And for the fifth and fourth finger, having a stiff DIP joint will not really affect your everyday life. Perhaps if your index finger and middle finger, then it will be a bit more tricky to do certain, like picking up needles and doing fine things. But for these ones, they are mostly to provide support to your power grip. They are more important than people think. When you grip like a hammer or something, the little finger is more important, I think, than the index finger many times. So, but making those stiff, the wrist stiff and the thumb stiff would save you a lot of trouble, but you kind of lose this, you know, the ideal hand, human hand.
Right. But, you know, again, this, so you can sort of see why the roboticist along there kind of gave up on using usually the biomechanics textbook as far as definitions and just went with pitch and yaw, because that's pretty much the way we do industrial robots as well, and the roll. Because the nice thing about the roll is like, it's so easy to just put it back here and have the whole forearm roll. So it's like, it's the easiest one. And I think if you look at the range of motion, that's the one where you get the most motion anyways out of your wrist. and people talk, you know, that's the one for opening the doorknob and everything else. Yeah. And then the pitch kind of comes in second place. You've got a fairly good range of motion, but not as much as people see. Is like a lot of times people assume, oh, easily plus or minus 90 degrees. Mm-hmm. And I challenge most people to try to do that. I mean, you're really lucky to get, you can't even get close to 90 degrees. Okay. I'm 66. So maybe there are people who could do a bit better, but even if you can get that down 90 degrees, it's very uncomfortable. So you're typically operating in that range. And then as far as going back this way, it's like, yeah, you do a little bit, but it's not as much as you do forward. So you get most of it this way. And in many ways, the full range of motion might be about 90 degrees, you know, 60 one way, 30 the other. And then there's yawing again. Do you know what the maximum range is on that? Because maybe 45 is being very generous.
So 45 ulnary, I think, but radially, yeah, it's less, 25, 30.
Right.
But yeah, the patients always complain if they can't make 90 degrees extension because everyone wants to do push-ups. So if they lose that, their life is ruined. And then when you look at them, like, how many push-ups do you really do? But it's something that they really like to do. So that kind of, but otherwise, when it comes to, like,
I don't know that I can get 90. If I pushed it back, is that,
you put your body weight on it, you
oh yeah. And then, but yeah,
but the optimists can do it on their fists. That's
I think there are a couple of Chinese mods also that have just been released that do it on the fist.
And now the thing with this motion here is, like, it's the motion that's the least important in the whole thing, but it's the hardest one to finally stick it in there because we got a motor here, then we got a motor for this, and then that one is like the very end of the chain. And then you've got to figure out, well, how do I put an actuator in there and a joint that will allow me to do that? So you got to get that darn thing in there. You got to get the cabling through it. And now the load that you've put on there just for that little movement now has to be carried by this actuator and by that actuator and going all the way up there. And you see everyone just like tripping over themselves with these different designs coming out of China and everything else with it. And someone kind of gave up and went more like a traditional, even then, industrial robot kind of wrist, which is completely wrong. They do what we would call a roll pitch roll wrist. In other words, not only can your hand roll here, but your hand can roll there. Redundant. You wouldn't want to do it, and it puts you in what mathematically is known as like a singularity right to begin. so you want it the other way. And you've even seen someone say, well, we don't want to put that rotation down here, it's just too hard to put it. Why don't we put it up here? And it ends up looking like a second elbow on the wrist, the way it breaks up. So it's a really tricky one. And you can see that Tesla's solution was to turn it into a parallel kinematic problem rather than a serial kinematic, which is why they have those two actuators out there. Yeah. And that design that they have, and it's really hard to see in that, but you can see it easier in the older Optimus videos. That is designed to have a lot of range of movement in the pitching direction. But when you go this way, the mechanism will bind up pretty quickly. So mechanically, it doesn't have a full range of motion. And it's like, so what?
Yeah. You know, it's like you come a long way with a little bit, I think. I mean,
yes.
If they're reaching for having him play the guitar, him or her, you would really need it, I think, to play at the high level. But if it's to be a construction worker or your babysitter or someone emptying the fridge and putting in new groceries, then you don't need it. But if they're going for the Optimus Prime and not just the Optimus, then I really think you need, I would like them to go there. But then also we don't have that many patients with prosthetics in our clinic, but it's going to become more and more common. You see that if the Optimus program kind of proceeds, you can really see that the prosthetics will become much more widely available, I think, because a prosthetic for the hand today would cost almost as much as they expect the whole Optimus robot to cost, like, I don't know, $30,000, like 300 Swedish pounds, up to $50,000, and the main problem is that patients, half of them, stop using their prosthetic. So should we, as a socialized medicine country, which we're in Sweden, we try to see what is best for most, and we have limited money. You could of course buy it yourself or with your private insurance, but it would be really nice if you could get the cost down to maybe $2,000 each or 10,000 each even, and then you just replace it if it breaks. I mean, if they crank out a few million bots every year, they could probably crank out 2 million hands every year and just... I like that video you showed, actually. Could you bring that up again? Or at least I think it's in the same clip. Another thing that I got a bit concerned about, or rather, this is the way they need to do it, but what's often forgotten, I think, is the sensory input. And Tesla has shown that they have these at least proposed tactile sensors for the fingertips when it holds the eggs and whatever. But if you look at the robot's head, you could really tell that it's, or I don't know if it followed the teleoperator or not, but the problem with the teleoperation, I think, is that the operator does not get the tactile feedback. At least I don't expect them to.
Exactly. There's no haptics.
And I can show you. So one of my colleagues, Dr. Nordmark, is part of his research. The research has been at looking at patients with the loss of sensation and how they use their hand-eye coordination. And it's quite... at least I think it's quite interesting to see. So this is basically the setup. This is where it came from. I can go back later. So it's a few pins, and they're going to move it to these slots. And here on the left is a patient with normal sensation of their fingers. And this dot here is where they're looking. So, the small dot. So they're looking at the pins and then at the holes even before they move their hand. So the eye hops over long before the fingers go there, because the fingers know that they're holding on to something and they can even feel it when they're picking it up. Whereas the patient with no sensation from their fingertips, they really have to look at the pin all the time. They really have to look at it and follow it over. They drop it and they have to look where they're putting it. And then the gaze, it's a bit frustrating just to look at. And then they look at the pin and they follow the pin with their eyes. So it's really frustrating for them to, first of all, just pick it up, but then they have to follow it with their eyes. And this probably might not be a big difference at the end, but it will hinder the way you teleoperate, because you will change the way that you're moving and how you're looking and how you're holding your hand.
Correct me if I'm wrong, but it seems as if there is more of the radius and ulna at play than the metacarpals in the twisting. And is that caused by the lack of sensation?
You mean that they're doing they need to see what they're doing. So it's quite common that they really over exaggerate their grip when then they hold it, because they can't feel how strong they're holding it either. And that's of course another part with the proprioception, like picking up the egg without crushing it or dropping it. What is the right amount of force? And if you don't feel anything in your fingers, that's impossible almost. You have to pinch as hard as you can, because you don't know if you're going to drop it or not. So
this is interesting. Scott, you've spoken in the past about the actuators and the force feedback that gets them to cut off and know just how much of pressure to apply. How does this cross over from what Gustav said?
Okay, so I think what we want to do is look at different sensory input. So when I think about the sensor input I have, sometimes it's hard to distinguish where the cutoff is between, but there's definitely the tactile and the pressure that you feel on your tips. But then there's also, let's say, a certain amount of tension that you can feel in your arms, so that I know I'm applying a lot of force, even if I don't feel it. So you could probably like numb your hands and you would know I'm applying a lot of force, because I can just feel the tension that's in there. So the actuators are feeling that force, because you can look at the current and everything else and know that this is the amount of torque I'm putting. Even if I'm not moving, for some reason, I'm having to apply a lot of current just to be able to get the torque requirement I need. And then there's the other part. And then the actuators also have encoders in there, which means they know their angles. Mm. So just by knowing the angles of all your joints, at least mathematically, you have what you need for the proprioception to know exactly where the hand is in space. So that's all you need. And the reason you know it is because the lengths of your arms, you know the angle that's in here. You just got to work out the math. The human body is a little bit different. We don't do the trigonometry that's necessary to do all those different calculations. we don't even know what the distance is from our elbow to here. I mean, we can see it, but I couldn't tell you the exact number. It's like, but I can tell you for a KUKA arm because it's right there in the spec sheet. So we get that proprioception from another way of that awareness that allows us to do, like, you know, this magic trick that I always show. And here is like, the idea is that I can grab this bottle, and then with my eyes closed, I already know how to get the tip of the bottle to touch any part of my body. So I want to touch my nose right there, my chin. I know I'm not even looking, yet I have the sense of and this isn't even a body part. Okay. Using my digits, it's a lot easier. I know exactly where they are when they move them around, no matter what. So we have this incredible sense of where everything is, even when our eyes are closed. And we seem to recalibrate almost every morning when we get up to do that. And I'm not doing that with any fingertip sensors on there, but something has happened in my body that visually I know where that thing is. It just becomes an extension of me. So the thing that I would expect is that, you know, once you get that in there, can they get that proprioception, or is that sensory so important for them to know? Because if it was in my finger, I would think at that point I would kind of know where it is, but it may be that this tactile input is way more important to my proprioception than I give it credit to. I mean, I'm assuming my proprioception is just my muscle groups being at a certain tension.
You have your muscles
to visualize it.
Yeah. Also, the joints, actually, the capsules of the joints have a lot of proprioceptive fibers in them, and also the tendon, the Golgi tendon apparatus tells all of this. I don't really know how much is in the tactile sensation and the proprioception. You most likely are helped by both, but it's definitely the fact that if you don't feel your fingertips, you're much more reliant on your eyes, not just in picking it up, but also keeping it in your fingers. As you saw, they drop the pin quite often when they try to do it. But that's where I guess the engineering part has the upper hand, because then for each actuator and each motor or whatever, you could probably get a lot of data about how much and how little, and perhaps the neural nets also can help in that you basically put it in the dojo and like, okay, you're going to pick up this egg now, which has physical properties, and you train the bot to pick it up a million times, and after a while it will know how hard can I, if I see an egg, how much can I squeeze it until it cracks.
Exactly.
Probably easier than trying to kind of program the actuators. It's not easy, but when you have
a vision-based system, can cover most of the sort of progress that you need.
And it's also kind of like the mental picture that the robot might get of the environment. So it might be able to go through and get a very accurate image of what's there, and also be able to supplement it within. So, for instance, I'm looking over my laptop right now. I don't see the back of the laptop, but I kind of know from experience where there might be a couple of ports back there that are difficult to reach. And I can take a thumb drive and I can get it in there. And part of it is I'll go through it with one hand. I will, with an index finger, I'll feel that's where the port is. Mm-hmm. The other one, I can come around and I can feel the force. And I can do it without doing visually, because mentally I kind of know it's there. Now, you can imagine the bot, it looks at the thing and it's able to say, oh, it's this kind of laptop. Look up the spec sheets, know exactly where it is. And also give it kind of a guess, but still,
it was still getting wrong. Know,
yeah, it'll get, but, you know, but having USB. Right, exactly. It'll take three tries to get the USB in there, I have something I call Scott's Law, which is kind of akin to that, and that is, when given 50-50 odds on something, you will pick the wrong thing 80% of the time. Mm-hmm. And like examples of that will be like, you're driving down someplace, you know, it's either this exit or the next exit, and you're not sure which one it is. Guaranteed, the exit you take will be the wrong exit every time, you know. So I've just seen that whenever I have the 50% odds, 80% of the time I get it wrong. And I think that's the same thing with the USB ports. And so that will be kind of an important component to be able to do it, because there's a little bit of proprioception. There's a little bit of that tactile feedback to kind of know where it is. There's other things is that, our tactile sensors are way more than just pressure points. A lot of times you want to know a little bit more. So when I'm holding on to this right now, I can feel that I'm applying a lot of pressure, and I might think the pressure is right. But if it just starts to slip, let's say I'm not putting the right pressure in there and it starts to move, if I feel the same pressure and I'm not feeling like a shear force, I have no idea that I'm dropping it. So your sensor has to be beyond just, can I feel the pressure? Is there also this, you know, if it's, is it twisting? Is it going up and down like that? To be able to sense a little bit more than that. Otherwise, you're going to be reliant purely on vision. I'm going to look at it and say, oh, the bottle's slipping down. I got to press it a little bit harder as it goes down. They may do a lot of cheating with the vision for now. I think you can get away with a lot of modalities you don't necessarily need, because the problem that humans have is that we are very focused this way, whereas the bot is able to see quite a bit. So even, you know, if I'm looking over here, I can't see the bottle slipping out of my hand. But if I'm optimist and I'm over here doing something, I'll see the bottle slipping out of my hand, even if I don't feel it slipping out of my hand. So they'll be able to get away with that.
Yeah. Optimist is like a mom. She's got eyes at the back of his head.
Yeah.
Like every mom. Okay. So I wanted to quickly circle back to a post. The post says the first bimanual torso created at Clone includes an actuated elbow, cervical spine, and anthropomorphic shoulders with a sternoclavicular, acromyoclavicular, scapulothoracic, and glenohumeral joints. The valve matrix fits compactly inside the ribcage. Bimanual manipulation training is in progress. Okay, so help us make sense of this.
I can take the joint.
I understand 30% of that. Gustav can help us with the rest.
So he put it up so we can see. Yeah, so basically the joints, I don't remember all of them, but so the arm is only attached to the torso with one joint at the end, and that's the sternoclavicular joint. There is no other joints connected to your torso. But then if you follow the clavicle, you reach the AC joint or the acromoclavicular joint, which is how the clavicle is connected to the scapula. But the scapula is actually floating with muscles keeping it in place. There is no real scapulothoracic joint. It's more like a scapulothoracic interface. So there's not really a joint there. So minus 1 point on their exam. And then you have the glenohumeral joint, which is actually the humerus to the scapula. And then they mentioned the elbow. So it's those joints. And as I mentioned earlier, if you look closely at some of these images, you can really see that it's a human skeleton that they most likely 3D printed, I hope. So it's really anthropomorphic in that way. And if you look at the cables, and most of them are kind of like where I would expect real muscle origins and insertions to be, aside from this bundle hanging down, which I can't really place, but you could kind of see one of the muscles I would remove if I did a fake robot or a fake human is the one reaching from here down to the radius, the brachioradialis. You could quite clearly see it in those arms, which kind of helps with the flexion and a little bit of prosupination depending on where your arm is. But that's not what an engineer would put there. It's just going to break when it crosses over the elbow joint probably. But you could see them trying to emulate the real fibers of the different parts. So I'm a bit sad that doesn't really move more naturally in this. It's quite stiff in many ways, but probably like you were into earlier, Scott, with the tubing being quite stiff and like inhibiting a lot of motions, because you would kind of expect it to be able to abduct all the way up and flex and extend more. Now it's just kind of looks like it has frozen shoulder or something.
Yeah, you see a lot of the biomechanics I talk to, and when we look at the humanoid bots, they keep on saying, they don't have the scapula in there. For them, the scapula is a very important kind of movement that you would want to add. It adds complexity and everything else. Are you seeing kind of that they have it? Because they mentioned that they have it.
So I didn't really think about that. You just got...
I guess the way to look at it is kind of like when you hunch your shoulders and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. It's like we imagine that ball and socket joint is rigidly fixed onto our torso. And it's really not. It seems like there's like this structure that holds it in there that allows us to, again, kind of shrug our shoulders and sometimes even bring our arms a little bit further forward. You think mechanically.
As an anatomist, I have a lot of skeletons.
All right. Good.
So basically, when if you just take the moving the arm out to the side, it's what we call an abduction of the arm, or extending it to the side, if you wish. So The first part of the motion is purely glenohumeral joint, but then the scapula will start to turn. So if you lock your scapula, you won't be able to abduct your arm further than here. But then starts to rotate outwards like this to facilitate your motion. And if you have what I mentioned earlier, a frozen shoulder where this joint isn't really moving anymore, you will directly start to move your scapula as you rotate it outwards. But as you mentioned, you can also shrug it forwards, like moving your shoulders forwards, or protrude or retract your shoulders, and that's the scapula gliding over your thoracic wall or over the muscles. And then, of course, you can elevate and depress your elbows. Rotation, protraction, retraction, elevation, and
it's a pretty complicated joint, and you can see sometimes that's what gives us the last inch. Mm-hmm. Or a couple of millimeters to reach that thing in the cabinet that you're trying to get, and all those. So, but for all the human,
you also need the rotation in your elbow. You see this tubercle, the bony part here on the humerus. It will kind of strike your acromion, or what's the part of the extradacy joint. So you need to rotate the arm as well to get around it. Get around that. So that might also be why would you try to. Because human anatomy and human movement it's evolved over millions of years or whatever, but it has some drawbacks. So,
but looking at that, this is interesting. You're showing that when your shoulder gets up to that point,
if you have your
suddenly forward, the bone locks and it forces you to do something different.
Keep your palm like this and you try to put up, you won't get further than here. But if you
supinate
it, then you can put it over your head. At least most people are like that. There are those who can probably hyperflex their joints.
It seems like it's like nature may have discovered that there's kind of like a mathematical problem, which I think the biomechanists call it like Codman's paradox. We call it like a mathematical singularity. It's like when these joints that are able to rotate come together, and it's about like that when you have that extension there, that you might have a position that's just going to be bad for your anatomy, that you try to put some sort of input in there and you get the muscles maybe basically twisting up on themselves. And it's also like nature decided, oh, we're going to put a little lock in there to make sure that they kind of get around there to avoid what seems to be singular. I mean, that's the first impression I have of looking at that from the issues I have of dealing with robotic arms and what they call the singularity. And if anyone doesn't know what that is, it basically means at some point in your math, you're dividing by zero, all right? And we all know you don't like dividing.
Not allowed to do that. No, I think that's, I mentioned the Mount Improbable. I think it was a book by Richard Dawkins. So when we look from evolution, which as an anatomist and medical scientist, I usually do. So we're slowly walking up the mountain towards having nice hand function. And you need to go through a certain few steps to get to the top. You can't just jump from having, I don't know, a tentacle, and then all of a sudden your child has a human hand. There are multiple steps along the route. You can't just scale the sheer wall of Mount Improbable. But engineers can do this. So if you have like, okay, how can I reach this function? Do I have to first build a special joint that then can then function with another, or do I just... I just invent this thing from the get-go. So we have a lot of, I froze here. Can you still hear me?
Yeah.
We can hear you. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. So we have a lot of bad anatomy with us. So the eyes is one thing, with the retina being on the wrong side, with the vessels in the way and so on. So there might be a creator, if you will, but he kind of put some errors in there for some reason, maybe to give me a job. But from an engineering point of view, maybe it's not ideal to look at what is the human anatomy function here. There's one thing to try to create the perfect humanoid robot that looks and functions exactly like us, but that's probably not going to be the ideal robot. I mean, if you want something that is faster, stronger, and more...
You don't need to go through that entire evolutionary process again.
Yeah.
You can start off from this new base, which is
us. Yeah, exactly. You could take what's functioning, but then perhaps for the shoulder joint, maybe you shouldn't try to recreate the glenoscapular joint and the AC joint. I mean, it's quite common to have shoulder dislocations and luxations because it's a quite weak joint. The joint surface is very flat and you have this round head, and it's just muscles and ligaments keeping it in place, and it's quite easy to dislocate if you have too much load or whereas the hip joint is perhaps more protected with like a more of a cup for your ball and socket. So but on the other hand, this design with a very flattish joint gives us this possibility of a wide range of motion, whereas if it was very enclosed in bone or whatever, it would be you wouldn't be able to do all the motions that we do with our arms. It's not
you couldn't do pull-ups.
And that's a beautiful segue, and I want to pull up the Boston Dynamics bot, because you see this is a crazy amount of freedom of movement.
That's nightmare fuel, I think.
Yeah.
So no human can do this, but again, it goes to the point that you don't need to replicate the evolutionary process of a human.
Yeah.
You can build on it as a new base and then advance it to make a bot far more flexible and reach difficult places a lot easier than any human can.
Yeah. So what I find as a hand surgeon, so it differs where you are in the world. There are different cultures where if you lose a finger, it's very traumatic and can be like a cultural stigma. So certain areas of the world, they are very keen on putting back the smallest piece of your finger if you cut it off. Whereas here in the Nordic or in the Western world, I'd say, if you lose one finger, it's quite hard to motivate putting it back. It's if you just suture the skin of your where the index finger was, you'll be back to work in a few weeks. You won't have 6 months of rehab and maybe extra surgeries just to get your finger to move, and you will still not have nice sensation. We can do it, but so looking at this, I think.
That's interesting. Why do you think that is? Is that cultural or is that?
So I think the human form, at least when I meet patients, it's. You take them by the hand and you examine their hand, and it's a very important part in how we interact as humans. And also now I'm talking a lot with my hands, and I think that's important. And the Tesla bot, as I said, that's nightmare fuel. When it moves in that way, we would probably become okay with it after a while. But if I meet something with a humanoid form, and it might be more easy to interact with depending on what function you want the robot to have. This is, of course, cool and can do a lot of things. But I'm kind of wondering if they say that the Tesla says that they want their Tesla bot to be able to do all the things that humans do. That's why they design it this way. But I kind of also think it has something to do with interaction with humans and the kind of.
Right.
Yeah. Because looking at the picture.
The 10-10 Wii Robot event, even the. The slideshow and the promo video that they had playing showed Optimus in the setting of a household, and watering the plants and opening, receiving packages, and opening stuff. So
there's some subtle body language that you want to get right. So at first, Optimus did not have neck movement, and part of the thing was put in there is because the teleoperators were like doing this, and they couldn't capture it, so they need to get a little bit better mapping. It has 2 degrees of freedom. It can't do this motion here, but it can do basically, you know, yes and no. And it can do it fluidly enough. So at the Wii Robot event, even though the teleoperators were moving around, it was kind of crisp and looked really nice and felt natural. And that made Optimus a bit disarming in that way, as it didn't feel frightening or mechanical. Now, to contrast this is that, in the Terminator movie, the very first Terminator movie, when the bot first shows up there, there's like this movement with the head that comes around that they intentionally made very robotic and did not want to be human-like. And it was one of those things that was just very visceral for a lot of people, and they saw it, that gave it like this, it was like, oh, that thing is like this horrible, from a subtle movement of the head. So you can see how important some of these motions are, and that you might say, again, you know, when they do a survey of the people working on these things, say, well, which joint can you take out? Some say, well, I'll take the one out of the neck. We don't need that. The other ones are more important. And then, so why do they bother putting them in there if they're not there? And part of it is just so you don't get that creep factor. Mm-hmm. And I think Atlas, it only does this with its head. I don't think it does that. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, just being able to combine the two together to get it like a bobblehead out of it will make it seem a bit more friendly than what it's mm-hmm. doing, whereas it's more like something out of The Exorcist than a friendly movie.
And I always start my presentations when the students are introduced to hand surgery or whatever good hand function is, and I always show pictures of human interaction, not like an anatomy picture of tendons and bones, but rather like the kid clapping the hand or the grandfather holding the grandchild in his hand. And then I throw in a slide of someone with a hook holding the grandchild in his hand and seeing what kind of emotions that evoke. So it's...
Do you see how important those head gestures were right there when handing the drinks? I mean, that's exactly what you'd expect, like from someone who's...
And it's looking, are you interested in something? The bot will know if you're looking at it to get its attention to order a drink, but if you look at them, then do you want?
And it wasn't just turning that I'm turning my attention to you, but also there was like that little head nod there, which is just kind of this confirmation, which is why both of those degrees of freedom are very important. And that's what that event was about. It was really about introducing the bots to a large body of people to see how they would react around it and whether it was dystopian or whether it was something like, wow, this is really cool. And for the most part, everyone felt it was very cool.
Yeah. And Scott, you were there. And I think John, as you said, John got a fist bump one.
Did he? Or did they stop him? Or
I think some of them, they allowed the fist bump. And I think there's a difference between the autonomous mode, which we've seen in one of these videos where it won't do that autonomously, but because it was telerobotically controlled, it was really up to the operator to decide. It's like, I'll kind of go ahead and do it this time. But I think they were a bit cautious about the fist bumps because if it's too hard or unexpected, the bot might lose its balance. And there was one situation that evidently a handbag got caught in Optimus' wrists, which, you know, is like an example of getting too close and caused it to fall over. So that was the only spill during the entire event, and that was because of something like that. So that's why they wanted to keep people away.
Mm-hmm. Still very impressive. I mean, I don't think people really realize that. It's probably not as easy when you're not there. I mean, if you're there and they're moving among you, like realizing, they're actually...
You see the bodyguards there? You see them? They were there the whole night. They're like, don't get close. Don't get close.
Don't trust it yet.
No, they trust it. They just don't trust the people. That was the thing.
That's just interesting.
Because if I was one of those guys and I didn't trust the thing, I wouldn't get that close either. So they trusted enough to get close, but they needed to make sure that other people just didn't do something that would have been considered unsafe behavior.
Now, Scott, you're what, 6'2", 6'3"?
6'3", yeah.
Okay, so how did it feel like in terms of height and size? And
I think Optimus is... I think like around 5'8". So
what's that in
metric? It didn't feel like Optimus would be able to overpower me or anything like that. So again, it wasn't intimidating, and that was part of the reason is that they could have built Optimus to be 6 foot or 6'6" or something like that. And then a lot of people would be really and maybe when they have like the security bot version, that's what they will do.
Right.
But the bot that's going to be in the house, they're choosing the height around different standards. And I think that the North American standard male, I think, is like 5'8". And so that's what they're... Because if you're planning on using it in factories, you're always looking at the ergonomics and distributions of different sizes. I mean, it comes down to like a car. When you're designing a car, you're trying to say it has to be able to fit from the 5th to the 95th percentile. That's where we usually kind of put it around. And the same thing with factories is that they're setting up all the workstations and everything kind of around that. And so you just like the sweet spot, 50 percentile, just put it right there. And so that's, I think, why they picked 5'8". Others have gone 5'6", and I think they've gone with that because that's like the 50th percentile female.
Right, right.
And again, it depends on your demographic. That's like, that's North America. You go to different countries and different
continents. You go to Asia, for example.
You'll be all over. Well, in Scandinavia, it's probably higher than that.
Yeah, probably around 6 feet.
Like 5, 10 or 6 feet.
Yeah, I'm the outlier there, so I'm optimist size, I guess. It's cold up here, you know, in the foreign.
All right. Well, gentlemen, it's been wonderful, so wonderful chatting with you. We've got to do this again, get together again, and talk about low-hanging fruit for optimists. Thank you once again. It's been so wonderful to have you, Gustav, on Over the Horizon. I hope we'll have you back more often and
start. Absolutely.
Anyway, our favorite roboticist. And of course, if you want to follow them, please do. They're both on X. Gustav is Anatomy Umeo. I hope I pronounced that right. Umeo is actually spelled with an A at the end and not an O as it's pronounced. And Scott, of course, is at Going Ballistic 5. Great. Thank you, gentlemen. And hope to see you again.
Same. Thanks.